Okay.
It's the story, Jesus's story, and it's told, it's experienced this film in the following languages, and there's all kinds of different languages. And these were handed to me. So you just choose the language when you play the, is this a CD? It'll be a CD.
You
I get
choose what
DVDs and
language,
CDs.
I think.
There's a whole bunch of
DVD.
different ones. I don't know much about
It's a
it.
DVD.
I don't know much about it, but if they're free and
Anybody want one?
if
They're free,
you
I'll take them.
might
They're
want it,
DVDs.
maybe you know somebody who
It's the
speaks some of the
Jesus
language.
film, and what they do with these is they use these all over Africa in different places, and people have been led to Christ all over the place. Thousands and thousands of people have come to Christ because of this video.
Do you have a German language one?
Yeah, there may be German on
Is
here.
it Dutch?
Let's see, I'm checking.
Deutsch? Does it say Deutsch?
Deutsch,
It
yeah.
says Deutsch. Yes, then it's German.
Yeah.
Okay, then, Teresa, can you bring that tomorrow?
Yes, I can.
Thanks.
I have to think, what am I doing tomorrow, Steve?
I don't know. Because it's not tomorrow. We don't know
Yeah.
what we're doing tomorrow because it's not tomorrow. Right? Is
Right.
that
Right?
right?
Okay. All right. 11 weeks ago, when I was asked to take one of these classes, I immediately jumped to Joshua because I was remembering the old days when we had 80 or 90 people in this room, and I was going to march us around and make us up and move in and all that kind of stuff. But now I have to deal with Zoom and I can't.
Oh, there's no sound again. I bet anything what's happening is that the space bar is getting hit and it will mute the Zoom.
There you go.
You got it. Here we are. Okay.
Okay.
So, what am I going to do with my friend? Well, I'm just going to hold it. So, one of the things that we did one other time was we took this off and pushed the computer back and gave room down here. Do you want to do that?
Yeah, let's do that.
All right. Can you hold the computer? There you go. Okay. Does that give you room then? Great. All right. We're going to look at the relationship between God and Joshua today.
God knew.
God and Joshua. They had quite a relationship.
Yes, they do.
Yes, they did. We first come into recognition, this guy by the name of Joshua in Numbers 19, where he is called Numbers 13 and 14. Let's see. I'll go to that. Where the spies are named. And the Lord spoke to Moses, saying, "Send men for yourself." So, representing Moses. So they can spy out the land of Canaan, which I am giving to the children of Israel. You will send a man from each tribe of their fathers, each one a leader among them. So, Joshua, son of Nun, is from the tribe of Ephraim. And Ephraim and Manasseh were the two sons of Joseph. So he is a son of Joseph.
I thought it was Ephraim.
I call it Ephraim. For tonight, it's Ephraim. So, and his name is Hoshea. And by the time we get to Joshua, it starts with a J. So every time you see the Hoshea, H-O-S-H-E-A, son of Nun, that's Joshua. So the 12 tribes chose a leader, and they were sent out to spy the land. And Moses, by the command of the Lord, sent them from the wilderness of Paran. All those men were heads of the children of Israel, and these were their names. I'm not going to go through all that. I'm just going to go to the tribe of Ephraim, Hoshea, the son of Nun, and from the tribe of Judah, Caleb, the son of Jephunneh. So the 12 went out, and when they got to the land of the Canaanites, it was rich in fruit and grains, and the people were organized into a people, one people, and 10 of the 12 leaders were terrified at the strength that they saw among them. They had weapons and they were armed. So they were very, very challenged by this, and they were quite afraid. But Caleb and Joshua were not. And so when the 12 came back, 10 said, "No, we're not ready to go in there. We're not organized. We don't, we're too recently from Egypt." So they said no. And Caleb and Joshua said, "We can do it." And Moses said, "Okay, we don't have agreement, so we're not going to go." And then God essentially said to Moses, "You're going to stay 40 years in the wilderness because you don't have the courage, the kind of courage you need to go into the promised land." So they stayed in the wilderness another 40 years. Joshua is mentioned in the book of Numbers that he was, Joshua and Caleb were right hands to Moses after that. And Joshua was singled out as someone who never left the tent of meeting. Now, what does that mean? When they built the tabernacle, within the door of the tabernacle was the tent of meeting. Within the tent of meeting was the Ark of the Covenant. So in saying Joshua never left the tent of meeting, it's simply saying the concept is Joshua was a discerning disciple of Moses. Someone that Moses could count on. So he became his first lieutenant through the 40 years. So by the time they get out of the wilderness and they're coming up on the east side of the Jordan River. And as they're coming up, they go through Edom and Moab, and God tells them, "Do not fight these people. Just go through their land. Do not cause any trouble." Then they reach the Amorites and the Hittites and the Girgashites and all those guys who are north, but still on the east side of the Jordan. And that's when God tells them to fight. And they conquer Sion, the king of Og, and Bashan. And those battles are in scripture. And they take that land. And Moses is still the leader. And during that time, Moses gives that land to Gad, Manasseh, and Reuben. So they have their territory on the east side of the Jordan River, which is now Syria and Jordan, modern, that territory. So the land at this period of time where the 12 tribes are coming in is larger than Israel has been in thousands of years, a couple of thousand years. So this is the initial 12 tribe promised land. So at this point, then, the book of Joshua starts. And it starts the end of Numbers. Mm-hmm. 27. Verse 12. And the Lord said to Moses.
Chapter 1,
verse Numbers. 12. Numbers. Chapter 27, verse 12.
Oh, 27.
The exchange of power and authority. This is when Moses delegates Joshua to take over the 12 tribes, the leadership of the 12 tribes. And the Lord said to Moses, go up on this mountain, Abiram, and see the land which I have given to the children of Israel. And when you have seen it, you too will be gathered to your people. So the Lord is telling Moses, it's your time. You're going to go home. You're not going to go into the promised land. That really bothers me. All those 40 years, he took all that struggle and rebellion from his people. But when he hit the rock to bring the water out, instead of just calling the water out, instead of just using the word of the Lord, he used the shepherd's crook to hit the rock. And then he was disciplined.
But he was frustrated with the people.
I know he was frustrated with the people, but he needed to do it the way the Lord said to do it. One of the concepts tonight is you are under instruction, guidance, and you do what the Lord says to do. And if you don't do what the Lord says to do, you will be disciplined.
We come to that place of maturity, right? As children, there's leniency.
Yes. Well, except they're still children. But what's happening? No, they aren't still children. You're right, Dorothea. The generation that came through the wilderness, okay?
Yeah.
They're dying out. So this story is about generational transfer.
Mm-hmm. Of power, which is where we are.
That's exactly right. Mm-hmm. That's what they said, do Joshua.
Yeah.
It's mm-hmm. generational transfer of power and authority. And for Moses, Moses doesn't get to go into the promised land, but he gets to see it. And then he turns it over to the one he has trained.
That's Bo Nebo.
Let's see, where am I here? And when you have seen it, you too will be gathered to your people, as Aaron, your brother, was gathered. So Aaron's already dead. For you rebelled against my commandment in the desert of Zin, in the strife of the congregation, to sanctify me in the at the water before their eyes. That was what was supposed to happen. The Lord God Almighty was to be sanctified with the water coming out of the rock. And when Moses chose to hit the rock, he put himself between the people and God. His own action, his own strength, his own power. No, you're not going to do that.
I never heard it that way. That's good.
I've been working hard on this because I hate this kind of discipline. I always want mercy.
Yeah.
Not mercy here. There is this strong, well, that is a kind of mercy, kind of different kind than we like.
Right.
So the people see that Moses, after all these years and all that he's done for God, isn't going to go to the promised land. What do you think that does to them as a people? They see this. They have to process this in their gut. You know, ooh, who is this God? And remember, these are people that for 400 years were slaves in Egypt.
Mm-hmm.
They went from a privileged people under the Pharaoh to absolute slavery. So there's more to the discipline than that. And Moses spoke to the Lord, saying, let the Lord, the God of the spirits of all flesh, set a man over the congregation who may go out before them and who may go in before them and who may lead them out and who may bring them in. So the congregation of the Lord, that's God's people, the congregation of the Lord will not be like sheep that have no shepherd. So Moses asked God to choose somebody. And the Lord said to Moses, so God does, take Joshua, the son of Nun, a man in whom is the Spirit, and lay your hand upon him. In other words, he has discernment. He has not left the tent of meeting. He may physically be out of the tent of meeting, but his spirit is still there. He's still connected. We call it, in our language, we call it a firm, complete God connection. Mm-hmm. And set him before Eleazar the priest and before the entire congregation, and give him a charge in their sight. And you will put of your honor upon him. So Moses is part of this exchange. He's supposed to put of the honor that's on him onto Joshua. That all of the congregation of the children of Israel may be obedient. So that's the reason for a lot of the discipline that's given. In other words, to humble the people of God. Because they get, you know, stiff-necked people who love to argue. And so again and again and again in the teaching, they are humbled before God over and over and over again. And he will stand before Eleazar the priest, who will ask him under the judgment of the Urim, which is the ephod that the priests wear, before the Lord. At his word will they go out, and at his word they will come in, he and all the children of Israel with him, even the entire congregation. Now, at this point, the Lord is saying to Moses that Joshua and all the people will go into the promised land. And Moses did as the Lord commanded him, and he took Joshua and set him before Eleazar the priest and before the whole congregation. And he laid his hands upon him and gave him a charge as the Lord commanded by the hand of Moses. So that's the transfer of power. Now, go to Joshua chapter 1. Now, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it happened that the Lord spoke to Joshua. So now here he's got that direct communication, just like Moses had. The son of Nun, Moses' minister. So the scripture calls him the minister of Moses, saying, Moses, my servant is dead. Now, remember, Moses left, went up on Mount Nebo. The people didn't go with him. So the people never saw Moses die. They weren't exposed to that. So God tells, even Joshua didn't go. So God tells Joshua, okay, Moses is dead now. Now, therefore, rise. Go over this Jordan, you and all this people, to the land which I am giving to them, to the children of Israel. Notice in all these directions that God gives, they're all commands. In other words, Moses can't argue with them. They're commands. He's under power and authority. And he wields that same power and authority. So it's a complete transformation that has happened in Joshua. Also, remember that the generation that left Egypt didn't go into the promised land. Their children went into the promised land. That's a very important piece. It takes a long time for the kingdom to manifest among mankind. Mm-hmm. Many generations consistently carrying the call for the promised land. So it wasn't done in 40 years. And then once they go in, it's not accomplished in a week.
7 years.
More than that. by the time Joshua dies, he surrenders his captaincy of the army. At that time, almost his entire life is spent making war. So they take the land slowly. Who wants to go to war all the time? You can see that, you know, I can actually feel the reluctance of people. You know, when we have this much, why do we need more? But God wants a complete work. He needs a complete work. And he's got Joshua under his power and authority. Joshua is willing. He's prepared. He's ready. He's disciplined. And then mistakes are made, even by Joshua. It's not perfect in this world. This is a geographical kingdom they're taking. By the time Jesus came, we were taking a spiritual kingdom. Because it was going to go out all over the world. The call was going to go out all over the world for the kingdom of God into the Gentile world. So the key was, okay, this is a spiritual kingdom first and foremost. In mankind, among mankind. So this is a big story here. It's a big story, but it's just the beginning of conquering the flesh in order for the spirit to be set free.
Amen.
Now, therefore, rise, go over this Jordan, you and all this people, to the land which I am giving to them, to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot will tread upon, that I have given to you, as I said to Moses, from the wilderness and this Lebanon, even to the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and to the great sea toward the going down of the sun, will be your border. There will not be
What were you reading? Sorry.
Chapter 1, Joshua.
Yes.
I am now in verse 5.
Oh, you're there. Okay, thank you.
There will not, and I'm using the One New Man Bible.
Okay.
There will not be any man able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I shall be with you. I shall not fail you or forsake you. Be strong. These are incredibly important words right here. Be strong. Be of good courage. For you will divide the land for an inheritance to this people, which I swore to their fathers to give them. Only be strong. Be courageous. In other words, it's not going to be easy. So you would observe to do according to the whole teaching which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or the left. Straight ahead. So you can succeed wherever you go. This book of the teaching, Torah, will not depart out of your mouth, but you will meditate on it day and night. In other words, he's not going to be allowed to leave the tent of meeting. He's not going to be allowed to leave the tent of meeting. He'll serve, but the tent of meeting is in him with the Lord.
Mm-hmm. That's good.
Similar to that, when Jesus died on the cross, the curtain over the Holy of Holies ripped, and the Holy of Holies was opened to anyone who would go in to meet with the Lord for the rest of time. For the rest of time. This is similar to that. He carries the tent of meeting in his soul, in his heart. Soul. Mm-hmm. And he listens for the Lord, and he's not allowed to leave it ever. So you can succeed wherever you go. This book of the teaching will not depart out of your mouth, but you will meditate it on it day and night, so you can observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will act wisely in all your ways, and then you will have good success. That's how we have victory. I'll read it one more time. But you will meditate on it day and night, so you can observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will act wisely. So apart from the word of God, you will never be able to act wisely. Be strong. Here he says it again, third time. Be strong. Be of good courage. Good courage is you do what the Lord tells you to do, with whether you understand what the outcome is going to be or not. You still follow the direction. Do not tremble. Do not be dismayed. For the Lord your God is with you wherever you go.
Amen.
Amen. I love that section. He's preparing. First, he prepares Joshua. Now watch what Joshua does. Then Joshua commanded the officers of the people, saying, pass through the center of the camp and command the people, saying, prepare provisions for yourself, for within 3 days, you will cross this, hear the words, you will cross this Jordan to go in to possess the land, which the Lord, your God, is giving you to possess. So he's drawing the people into the same call he has. So they become one. And Joshua spoke to the Reubenites and the Gadites and to the half tribe of Manasseh. So I'll tell you this part. Those three tribes were already had their land. They were settled in their land on the east side of the Jordan. Remember, I described that to you. So he made them promise, well, he asked them to give their word that when the other 9 tribes crossed the Jordan, that they would go first and make and be first to do battle, because they already had their land. I love that. I love that. You've already got your reward, but that doesn't mean you're not part of this.
You're not done, in other words.
Not done. You're not done. Right. Because it's 12 tribes. It's not 3 and 9. It's 12. And they held on to the fact that they were one people. And I think that the discipline that is experienced by the people has a lot to do with that. That they had to stay one people. And if they couldn't stay one people, they were not going to have victory. They had to have that because the assignment was horrendously difficult. They were the ones that went into the promised land had never known stability. They were not of Egypt. They were of the wilderness, nomadic. They had moved around and moved around and been disciplined over and over and over again, along with the adults that were whining and complaining all the time. So now that generation is not going into the promised land. It's the generation born in the wilderness that's going in. So this is a brand new experience for them. And the way he takes them in there sets them up to tell this story over and over and over again to the generations that come behind them. Why? To hold the 12 tribes together as one. In support of each other. And it was very hard to do. And the prophets that came after him all pointed to that kind of thing over and over again, because they drifted apart. They had their territory. They became territorial. and they lost their oneness. Over and over and over again, they're disciplined to come back to their oneness. And then finally, they scream at Samuel and say, "We want a king." So this is the period between the wilderness and the promise, taking the promised land, and the judges. So very difficult time. There's a teaching. I don't know whether it's just traditional, but it's a teaching among the Jews that all beginnings are hard.
And all beginnings are hard?
All beginnings are hard. All beginnings mm-hmm. are hard. And I think we testify that to in our own lives.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah. When you're doing something you've never done before, it's hard.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the time, we don't get it right the first time. I don't like to do things twice, but often I have to go back and start all over again. Sometimes I have to get help. But quitting is not an option if it's about God's call and his commands. It's just not an option. And if you do make it an option, you're going to get disciplined pretty harshly, because he will have us one. He will have us one. That is the will of God, that we will be one, that his people will be one. Go to verse 16. Well, let's see. Wait a minute. He addresses those three tribes, and they give their word that they will do that. And so they answer Joshua, verse 16. All that you command us, we will do, and wherever you send us, we will go. So they got a solid, he got a solid yes from them. In the same way as we listen, now this is really important. In the same way as we listen to Moses in all things, so will we listen to you as long as the Lord your God is with you. So they lay up, Joshua, as long yes. as the Lord, the God is with Joshua, they will listen to him as they listen to Moses. So they lay a trip on Joshua. Don't you deviate either, or we won't listen to you. Whoever he is who rebels against your command and will not heed your words in all that you command him, here's the discipline, he will be put to death. Only be strong and of good courage. So that's the key cry of the people of God. I must be strong and of good courage. Good courage is different from human courage. Human courage is to survive, not to die. Good courage in scripture has nothing to do with whether you live or die. It has to do with whether you obey the word of God. Because sometimes the word of God is not satisfying humanly, but it is always victorious. Always victorious. And whether you get to celebrate the victory or not is not that important to God. Whether you obey is important to him. Are you for me or against me?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And when there's a generational transfer going on, the key is that we are for him, or that transfer doesn't happen. And the sins of the fathers are transferred. It has to be a clean transfer, and it has to be by the hand of God.
So the Elsa Jane, so the transfer from the Old Testament to the New Testament also was painful.
Oh, that was huge, yeah. And the different kings, the transfers of the power from the different kings.
Yeah.
It goes on and on through the generations.
Yeah.
When I was attending the synagogue, Rabbi Stamfer was the rabbi there. in one of the sessions I had with him, he said, and this is a Jewish teaching, remember Jesus was Jewish. He said that the sins of one generation are not the responsibility of the next generation. And that's a very important teaching. So the sins of my generation, no one in the generation following my children's generation, they are not responsible for my sins. My grandchildren then are not responsible for my children's sins. So we deal with our own generation, and we must complete. Moses completed. Moses completed, did the transfer of power. Joshua took it up, and the Lord kept Joshua in step, just like he kept Moses in step, except when Moses acted out of frustration and weariness.
Where was Caleb?
Caleb is part of the tribe of, Caleb's part of the tribe of Judah, and he doesn't play a role yet.
Elsa Jane, can I ask a question? This is Matisse.
Absolutely.
So I got confused here because you were saying that you talked about generational transfer, and yes. You said it must be clean and by God. And then you said something about, or unless the sins of the fathers go on the sons. But then I hear you saying the sins of one generation is not responsible for the previous generation. So I got confused.
That's the truth.
Okay.
But because we don't make a good, clean generational transfer, those sins often go along. We take them along with us.
Got it. Okay.
We take them. That's not God doing it. That's not God doing it. That's us doing it.
So
we carry the sins forward because we have not received power and authority, which is the baptism of the Holy Spirit. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is the reception of power and authority. And it is then that you train under that Spirit.
So there's an exchange of fathers.
Yes.
So then in the exchange of fathers, you change from the earthly father to your heavenly father. And in that you take on a new bloodline, mm-hmm. and you are grafted into the vine, mm-hmm. and you are one with the father and the rest of the body.
And you never leave the tent of meeting.
And you never leave because that is your new life. That is your transfer from one life of death into life.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So what does Joshua do here? He immediately does something similar to what Moses did with him. Moses sent out the 12 spies. So here's chapter 2, verse 1. And Joshua, the son of Nun, secretly sent two men as spies out of Shittim, saying, go view the land and Jericho. And they went and came into the house of a harlot named Rahab. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that Rahab was a prostitute. It could mean that she was a keeper of an inn, that she took in lodgers. We don't know for sure.
It says she's a harlot.
It does say that, but down here it says, some say Rahab was an innkeeper, others that harlot is a metaphor for her being an idolater. We don't know, but we read it the way we understand it. And the king of Jericho was told, saying, behold, men of the children of Israel came in here tonight to search the country. And the king of Jericho sent to Rahab, saying, bring forth the men who have come to you, who entered your house, for they have come to search out the whole country. Now the people of Jericho they knew of the conquering of the Amorite and the Jebusite and the Hittite. They knew that they'd been conquered. They knew of complete annihilation of those people. Kings hung from trees. So they knew that. They knew that that had happened. They were aware of the brutal power to conquer. And they saw it from a human perspective. They didn't see God. They just saw a people who were coming for them. And they were afraid. So they wanted to catch these spies so no information could get back to the people so they would be better prepared because they knew they were coming for him. And the woman took the two men and hid them and said, men came to me, but I did not know where they were from. And it was about the time of shutting our gate when it was dark and the men went out. Where the men went, I do not know. Pursue after them quickly before you will overtake them. What kind of woman is she?
Be shrewd.
Be strong and have good courage. Now these two spies, okay, they recognize that.
Well, technically she didn't know where they were in the house.
Hmm?
They were in her room.
They were in
she
a house.
She didn't know where in the
house. Well, she had hid them.
Well, I know that.
Mm-hmm. But she had brought them up to the roof of the house and hid them with the stalks of flax, which she had laid in order on the roof. And the men pursued after them, they believed her, and they pursued after them all the way to the Jordan, to the fords, and as soon as it had pursued after them and had gone out, they shut the gate. So the ones that were pursuing were outside the city, the spies were inside the city, hiding on the roof of Rahab's house. And before they had lain down, she came up to them on the roof, and she said to the men, now here's another indication of who she was. I know that the Lord has given you the land. Okay? She's very decisive, isn't she? There's discernment there. I know that the Lord has given you the land. Now, she was not Jewish. She was not of the Hebrew people. She was a Canaanite. And that your terror has fallen on us. And that all the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea, so they know the whole story from the Exodus on.
What happened 40 years ago, they remember.
Yeah. So these people, the people of the Lord are famous.
Mm-hmm.
That's another reason for tough discipline. They're a reflection of who God is. And if they misstep, the reflection is broken. So that's like Moses hitting the rock. That was not a reflection of God. That was a reflection of Moses' frustration and weariness. And God wanted himself to be revealed to the people. When you dried up the water of the Red Sea for you, when you came out of Egypt and what you did to the two kings of the Amorite, that's Sihon and Og, who were on the other side of the Jordan, whom you utterly destroyed. As soon as we had heard these things, our hearts melted. Neither did we remain any more courage in anyone because of you. For the Lord your God, he is God in heaven above and earth beneath. This is a Canaanite woman's confession of faith. She was doing better than some of the Hebrew people. Now, therefore, please swear to me by the Lord, since I have shown you loving kindness, there's the mercy seat, that you will also show loving kindness to my father's house and give me a true sign. There's as you give, so shall you receive. And you will save alive my father, my mother, my brothers, my sisters, and all they have, and deliver our lives from death. And the men answered her, our life for yours, if you do not tell this our business. In other words, keep it secret that we've been here. And it will be when the Lord has given us the land that we will deal in loving kindness and truth with you. Now here's the discipline. Then she let them down through the window by a rope, for her house was on the town wall. And she lived on the wall. And she said to them, go to the mountain. She even told them how to escape. She gave him a plan. Go to the mountain, lest the pursuers meet you, and hide yourselves there 3 days until the pursuers have returned, and afterward you may go on your way. So she knew the pursuers would quit.
She took authority.
Yeah, she was very familiar with her own people.
Yeah.
And the men said, that's we think of her as a harlot. Mm. And the men said to her, we will be blameless. This is their agreement back. The men said to her, we will be blameless of this your oath, which you have made us swear. Behold, when we come into the land, you will bind this line of scarlet cord in the window by which you let us down. And you will bring your father and mother and brothers and your father's entire household home to you. And it will be that whoever goes out of the doors of your house into the street, his blood will be on his head. And we will be guiltless. And whoever is with you in the house, his blood will be on our head if any hand comes upon it. Mm-hmm. There's the sense of responsibility. You will respond as you have said. Your word must be good. If it is not, you're done. That's incredible discipline in the first years of the transference of power. So I think of it this way. You have a little child. You're married, you have your first baby, okay? If you allow the baby to control you, what happens?
It takes over.
Pardon me?
It takes over.
It takes over. Think of a two-year-old. If you don't discipline them firmly, what happens? They take the lead. Rebellion sets in.
Mm-hmm.
And their word overcomes your word. Well, in this particular story, no word must overcome God's word. That's the whole point. And this is the way the people are being taught to deal with their neighbor. And she said, according to your words, so be it. And she sent them away and they left. And she bound the scarlet cord in the window right then and there. And they went and came to the mountain and stayed there 3 days until the pursuers had returned. And the pursuers sought them throughout all the way and did not find them. So the two men returned and came down from the mountain and crossed and came to Joshua, the son of Nun, and told him everything that had they beheld that befell them. And they said to Joshua, truly, truly, the Lord has delivered the whole land into our hands, for even all the inhabitants of the country are faint-hearted because of us. Sounds like Caleb and Joshua 40 years before. So would Joshua recognize this as a sign to go? It's time. It's time to go. Okay. Now Joshua has to have instructions on how to do this. I love this part. And this is the part I always like to dramatize. Because it's so weird. No one goes to war this way. No one. By the time of Jesus, he went to war in his spirit. Okay. Here, it's a physical war led by the Holy Spirit of God through Joshua. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and they left Shittim and came to the Jordan. He and all the children of Israel stayed there before they crossed over. And it was after, this is the circumcision. Drop down to verse 5. Oh, wait a minute. After 3 days that the officers went through the camp, and they commanded the people, saying, when you see the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord your God and the priests, the Levites bearing it, then you will leave from your place and go after it. Yet there will be a space between you and it, about 2,000 cubits by measure. Do not come near it. Remember when Moses went up the mountain, the people weren't allowed to touch the mountain But here it is again. It's the Ark of the Covenant, but they're not allowed to touch. So you can know the way by which you must go, for you have not passed this way before.
Mm-hmm.
There's a beginning. That's a new beginning. You've not passed this way before. Do not touch the Ark of the Covenant. Do not touch the holy place. The holy place will touch you. And Joshua said to the people, sanctify yourselves, for tomorrow the Lord will do wonders among you. And Joshua spoke to the priests, saying, take up the Ark of the Covenant and cross before the people. And they took up the Ark of the Covenant and went before the people. And the Lord said to Joshua, this day I shall begin to magnify you in the sight of all Israel. So they will know that as I was with Moses, so shall I be with you. And you will command the priests who bear the Ark of the Covenant, saying, when you come to the brink of the water of the Jordan, you will stand still in the Jordan. Sound familiar? The Red Sea. Yeah. So it's a reflection of the story they already knew. So God didn't leave them totally unprepared. Their elders had told them the story over and over as they grew up in that 40 years. They were fully cognizant of what the Lord had done. So here they are. They're starting another 40 years to conquer this, the Canaanites, which they never do finish. And so there's this hope in them that God is still the God of this 40 years. When we, as family members, we come into our adulthood, we have to decide how much of the story we came from comes from God and how much doesn't. How much we can hold on to and how much we can't. One of the things I say about my family of origin is, I am just so glad that the name God was prevalent in our family, that word was there. And it caused me not necessarily to follow as a youngster, but to be aware, to be awake to that familiarity, to be familiar with that name. And then once you're familiar with the name, then God chooses you, and you have to decide whether to choose back. And this is what's happening right here in this transformation or transfer of power and authority. The people, the 12 tribes, have to decide whether they're going to obey the voice of Joshua that comes from the word of God. So the first thing that they require is a circumcision.
Circumcision.
Yeah. So they Joshua gathers the children to circumcise them because they weren't circumcised in the wilderness. So all the men of the 12 tribes needed to be circumcised again. Not again, but it was a second circumcision, but their first. So then all the warriors were laid up for a week healing before they could go into Jericho. So here we have the people in Jericho behind the walls, Rahab knowing that they're terrified. And we have the people of God outside the walls recovering from circumcision. Now, when I say the people of God, I'm just going to tell you about the tribe of Ephraim, because I don't want to get this too big. The tribe of Ephraim consisted of 40,500 people. 40,500 people in the tribe of Ephraim.
Just one tribe.
One tribe. And it was a half tribe. Yeah, just huge number of people camped in the valley around Jericho, not moving. I mean, they're there recovering from circumcision.
So now you gentlemen know what it takes to serve the Lord.
This is
that'd be terrible.
No, it's not easy. In other words, it's painful. There are losses, there's misunderstandings, there's confusion, there's chaos, there's excuses, there's all these things that we go through. But when the Lord speaks, that's when you just say yes and you do it. And then all of the craziness falls away from you, at least, as you obey. And this is what happens almost completely to the people of God, these millions who are gathered together in the valley outside Jericho. They cross the Jordan with the Ark of the Covenant, with the priests carrying the Ark of the Covenant. Joshua builds an altar in the midst of Jordan River, 12 stones that scripture says it's still there today. I haven't heard that it's been discovered, but scripture says it's still there today. And then once they crossed and hit dry land, each one of the leaders of the 12 tribes had to carry a stone across the river onto dry land, and they built another altar on dry land. In order to commemorate every generation, this is what this altar is about. I want to point out that an altar is very symbolic, because all of the false gods had altars on which they sacrificed children and women. So an altar is a key point in a faith, a religion, a belief. And part of the problem was that they were entering a land where there were all these altars to these other gods. So they themselves were commanded to build altars so they could refer from that altar. This is the story. And the altar they built on the land, Joshua wrote on the stones, the whole lessons, all the lessons from Moses. So the law was written on those stones. So they could always refer the children, oh, this is what this is about. Because the children would say, what is this? And they would have the opportunity to tell it. And you can see that in the Passover meal. It's the same idea. What is this? What is this on our door frame? And then they would tell the story. The Passover meal, what are the bitter herbs? You know, what is the lamb slain? What is the story? What is the story? So the Hebrew people are great, even today, great storytellers, incredible storytellers. And so they represent God with story. And so that's why I wanted to read this, since we couldn't dramatize it today. I decided, okay, I'm going to read the story. And children lap up stories. They just love them. And then they memorize them and can tell them, they can tell them themselves. I know my kids that I read stories to them all the time. And they learned them verbatim in their heads, and they could even do the, what do you call it? They could mimic the storyteller. It was just amazing. And that's why the story is so important. So anyway, they get ready to go in, and then they get the instructions from the Lord. Go to chapter 6. Now Jericho was closed up tight because of the children of Israel. No one went out and no one came in. What's that called? Militarily. I can't think of the word. Romans. Pardon me?
Shut in. No, shut in.
Yeah, they're hemmed in.
Yeah.
They're hemmed in by their fear.
About a siege.
Siege, that's the word I'm looking for. Thank you very much, Nick, my military. Okay. And the Lord said to Joshua, see, I have given Jericho and its king and the mighty men of valor into your hand. The Lord said to Joshua, see, they're already yours. Now, what's the definition of they're yours? They're terrified of you. They will just... lose immediately. When you come in, their fear will kill them. They're dying of fear. They're dying of terror. No courage. Remember? Be of good courage. They're dying of lack of good courage. No connection, in other words. And the Lord said to Joshua, see, I've given Jericho and its king and the mighty men of valor into your hand, and you will circle the city, all your men, to God, who had been content. What? You will circle the city, all your men of war. So it's the men of war that are in this. You will do this 6 days. And seven priests will bear seven shofars. Can you imagine? We hear the shofar at the Good Friday meeting. Can you imagine? There's seven of them that are going to blow. And on the seventh day, you will circle the city seven times. So each of the 6 days, they circle once. And the shofars blow. On the seventh day, they circle seven times. And on the seventh time, the shofar blows. And it will be that when they make a long blast with the ram's horn, when you hear the sound of the shofar, all the people will shout with a great shout, and the wall of the city will fall down flat, and the people will ascend, each man straight before him. How badly do you think that these warrior men wanted to shout? For 6 days, they silently... These are men who they're fighters. They were fighters, okay. And this is the description that the Lord gave them. Go around that city one time in silence, and let the shofar blow. Do it 6 days in a row.
And that's not a battle plan.
Not a human one. Not a human, but it was a holy one. So there was something going on there.
It was brewing, it happened.
Yeah.
It's all been
the terror was growing inside the city.
Been there.
But what was going on for the warriors?
The warriors and
the Hebrew march. Warriors. What was happening to them? 6 days in a row, one time around. This is what they were to do battle. One time around and blow the shofars.
That'd be hard.
That would be so hard.
So hard.
So hard. So on the seventh day, seven times around. If it were me, if I was, and I'm a warrior type, if it were me, by that time, I would have given up all sense of understanding anything. I would be completely at the mercy of the Holy Spirit. And I think they were. So when they were given permission to shout, what kind of shout do you think they gave? Okay. All the frustration of not being able to go in the city and take them, everything, all that frustration, all that angst, all that, let's get this done. Can you imagine it? Shout! Everybody do it. Shout! Did I hear you on Zoom? Did you shout?
Yeah.
And there were a million of them or more. I cannot imagine the volume of
yeah.
them.
Yeah.
I cannot imagine. But this is holy war. And there is no other war kind of war that's holy. All other wars are hell. Holy war is done under the direction of the living God.
Different kind of fighting.
Yes. Now what happens after this? And Joshua, the son of Nun, called the priests and said to them, take the Ark of the Covenant and let seven priests carry seven shofars of ram's horn in front of the Ark of the Lord. And he said to the people, pass by and circle the city and let the armed men pass on before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. So now the Ark of the Covenant, remember, is in travel, is the tent of meeting.
It's what?
It's the tent of meeting. It's symbolically, because when they camp and they set up the tabernacle, the tent of meeting was inside the door of the tabernacle. And that was where the Holy Spirit rested. So it was the Holy of Holies. So here it is. They've taken the covenant or the ark out of the physical tent of meeting, but they're carrying it in them. And remember that nobody's allowed to touch it because they'll die if they do. So it's a holy, 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 holy piece. And it terrifies the enemy. So all of this thing, this unusual, weird thing, is just terrifying the people in Jericho even more. And it was when Joshua had spoken to the people that the seven priests bearing the seven shofars of ram's horns passed on before the Lord and blew the shofars. And the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord followed them. And the armed men went before the priests who blew with the shofars. And the rear guard came after the Ark, the priests going on and blowing with the shofars. And Joshua had commanded the people, saying, "You will not shout or make any noise with your voice. Neither will a word proceed out of your mouth until the day I bid you shout." I think it's wonderful that the Lord shuts us up, because our words are so important, especially if we represent him. What comes out of our mouth is so very important. And so he silenced these people for 7 days. They weren't allowed to have a word come out of their mouth. "You will not shout or make any noise with your voice, neither will a word proceed out of your mouth until the day I bid you shout. Then you will shout." So the Ark of the Lord circled the city, going around once, and they came into the camp and stayed at the camp. And Joshua rose early in the morning, and the priests took up the Ark of the Lord, and seven priests bearing seven shofars of ram's horns went on continually before the Ark of the Lord and blew with the shofars, and the armed men went before them. But the rear guard came behind the Ark of the Lord, the priests going on and blowing with the shofars. And the second day they circled the city once and returned to the camp. They did this 6 days. And it happened on the seventh day that they rose early about dawn and circled the city the same way 7 times. Only on that day, they circled the city 7 times. And it was at the 7th time when the priests blew with the shofars, Joshua said to the people, "Shout!" The Lord, he said, "Shout! The Lord has given you the city." So he claimed victory before they shouted. Very important. Power of the word of power and authority. "And the city will be accursed, even it and everything in it, to the Lord. Only Rahab the harlot will live, she and everyone with her in the house, because she hid the messengers that we sent. She practiced mercy, therefore she would survive. And you," here's an important piece, "in every way keep yourselves from any accursed thing, so you do not make yourselves accursed when you take of the accursed thing." In other words, don't attach to anything that is of false gods, including people. "And make the camp of Israel a curse and trouble it. But all the silver and gold and vessels of bronze and iron are consecrated to the Lord." They don't belong to his people. They belong to him. "They will come into the treasury of the Lord." So the people shouted when the priests blew with the shofars, and it was when the people heard the sound of the shofar and the people shouted with a great shout that the wall fell. So that the people went into the city, every man straight before him, and they took the city. And they utterly destroyed all that was in the city, man and woman, young and old, ox and sheep and donkey, with the edge of their sword.
It was a Jericho, right?
What's the purpose of that kind of massacre? What is the Lord?
It can't rebuild.
that was part of it. They, I mean, that they couldn't rebuild it. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Why would God want to annihilate a people who were in terror?
They were practicing too many idols.
Just like he didn't let the generation from the wilderness go into the promised land. All beginnings are hard. So the discipline has to be recognized as something you don't want to have happen to you. Because the temptations were everywhere. They were going into a land where there was temptation everywhere they went, everyone they met. They were going to be tempted over the top. And so the discipline had to be incredible.
So the people were defiled.
Mm-hmm.
And God did not want his people in England to be becoming defiled.
Mm-hmm.
Nick has his hand up. Go ahead, Nick.
Go ahead, Nick.
What came to my mind was there couldn't be any unbelief left there. And with that, I think of when Jesus went to heal the girl. Can't think of her name right off. Tabitha, maybe?
Oh.
That there were the mourners in there and the people were laughing that he says that she's asleep and he's, anyway, you know that story, that Jesus sent everybody out except his disciples and the parents, that you can't have any unbelief hanging around.
They had to have a pure heart. An attachment to anything that was of evil was forbidden.
And absolutely. Rahab had a clean heart.
Yeah.
So she survived.
Yeah. Right. Go to verse 26, chapter 6, verse 26.
Elsa Jane, I wanted to point out too that I feel like when I hear you say all beginnings are hard and then recognizing the discipline, it feels like to me that to avoid the discipline of God, you have to be disciplined, right? And you're
that discipline.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you have to know that. And if you have had a life where you could take control and be an authority over everybody around you, you don't know that this discipline was not, you didn't experience it. You can't find goodness in it. And there is goodness in discipline. Discipline, the root word of discipline is disciple. And the root of disciple is teaching. So student. So in these stories, we have the teacher, who is the Holy Spirit and his representative, and the students. And so in each story, the relationship between the teacher and the student is explained, it's described in the action. And the Lord God Almighty works with his students, not against them. He works with them. So discipline, discipleship becomes the critical need. And that, remember they all said that they would respect Joshua as God's representative. So that was their word. It was firm. We'll go with you. We'll do what you ask. Just as we did with Moses. Well, if they didn't, what did that indicate?
Rebellion.
Rebellion. Right. This is what we had in the garden. I hear Adam saying, it's this woman you gave me, God. In other words, God, it's your fault. I didn't obey, but it's your fault. Same with Eve. Oh, the serpent tempted me and I ate it. Eve, you had instruction. Well, I guess Adam, some say Adam had the instruction. Did he give it to Eve? I don't know that for sure. But anyway, it started right. All beginnings are hard. Abraham and the sacrifice of Isaac. Woo! Did he obey?
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. I look at that and I think, oh my gosh, could I survive such a challenge?
It was a test.
That's another word for it. Yeah, it was a test. God tests us in order to strengthen us, not to destroy us, but to strengthen us. That's his whole will, that we will be strong and of good courage.
So also Jane, Joshua went through a discipline. He's the one that came back with a good report.
Yes.
When they spied out the land. And then he was disciplined with the rest of them for 40 years in the desert.
Yes. Yes. But he was right-hand man to Moses. He became a disciple.
Yeah. Yeah.
He was trained for the job. Did he know he was going to be trained? Did he know he was going to get the job? No, he did not.
Right.
Well, I've never understood Aaron got involved with those people.
Why Aaron built the golden calf, you mean? Because he was afraid. Moses didn't come down in a timely fashion. It didn't come down from the mountain in a timely fashion. So Aaron turned and pleased the moaners and the groaners.
It's easier to go along with the crowds.
Well, yeah. Because he didn't know, Aaron didn't know, but he didn't have the kind of faith that Moses had.
Well, it didn't cost him anything.
Oh, yeah, it cost him. Yeah, they got disciplined.
Yeah, we did. But I mean, while he was doing it.
Yeah, well, that was in the early part of the 40 years. But, you know, part of the tribes were slain in the wilderness, too, for their misdeeds.
Yeah.
So this is not the first time that we have a problem where a whole family is wiped out among the people of God, which is very, very hard to swallow. And I find that most churches don't like to teach this part.
No, they don't. Most people don't like to hear it.
I don't like to hear it, but well, it's there.
We're in a really tough time where people can't hear a hard word anymore.
Yeah. God is not here to please us. He is here to lead us. If anybody's supposed to please anybody, it's us. We're supposed to please God.
Sorry, say that again. Please say that again.
I said, God is not here to please us.
Yeah.
He is here to lead us.
To what? To lead us. Okay.
Lead us.
Okay.
And if we decide to please moaners and groaners, whiners and criers, if we decide that pleasing them is what we must do, then we turn our backs on God. Because we're not strengthening them, we're weakening them. And his purpose is to strengthen us. Be strong. Be of good courage. So the first thing that happens is Achan of the tribe of Judah takes spoil into his tent. And so the next battle is the battle of Ai. I'll just tell you this rather than read it. And Joshua sends spies to Ai, and they come back and they say, oh, we don't need the whole army, but just send 3,000 in there. It's a small place. There's not that many of them. We'll just run over them. Don't worry about it. So they're flexing their muscles from the victory at Jericho. Okay. Their war blood is up. And so Joshua doesn't talk to God. He sends the 3,000 in, and the people of Ai come out to do battle with him, and the Hebrew people turn and run. That's not going to work because they're supposed to have victory. So the other battles that are ahead, the fear is planted. So Joshua is fit to be tied. So he tears his robe and he throws dirt all over, dust over himself. Okay. Joshua tore his clothes, chapter 7, verse 6, and fell to the earth on his face in front of the ark of the Lord until evening. He and the elders of Israel and put dust upon their heads. And Joshua said, "Alas, Adonai, Lord, why have you even brought this people over the Jordan to deliver us into the hand of the Amorite to destroy us?" That's your intention, to destroy us? This is very Jewish. I'm not arguing with God, but he's contending with him. Pages or so. Get stuck together. I can't get them apart. There it is. Would to God we had been content and stayed on the other side of the Jordan. There's a challenge. Remember, he is a leader. He is a strong and focused man. He can, God will permit him to contend. He will not be disciplined for contending, only disobeying. Oh my Lord, what will I say when Israel, now he's reasoning. Oh, my Lord, what will I say when Israel has turned their backs before their enemies? For the Canaanites and all the inhabitants of the land will hear of it and will surround us and cut off our name from the earth. And what will you do about your great name? How are you going to defend yourself, Lord, if that happens? Now he's challenging the Lord. Now this is what's happening. He's becoming of age. He's maturing under this pressure as a leader. Remember, he just bought the 3,000 will do it without talking to the Lord. So he's getting his comeuppance now. And the Lord said to Joshua, "Get yourself up." I love this. The Lord is a great warrior. "Why are you lying like this on your face? Israel has sinned, and they have also trespassed my covenant, which I commanded them. For they have even taken of the accursed thing and have also stolen and denied also, and they have put it even among their own things." Okay, so what happens now is Joshua calls all the tribes one by one and questions every family in the tribe. And finally, verse 16, Joshua rose up early in the morning and brought Israel by their tribes, and the tribe of Judah was taken. Now this is Caleb's tribe. And he brought near the family of Judah, and he took the family of the Zerites. And he brought near the family of the Zerites by man, and Zabdi was taken. And he brought near his household man by man, and Achan, the son of Carmi, the son of Zabdi, the son of Zerach, of the tribe of Judah, was taken. And Joshua said to Achan, "My son," interesting address, "give, I pray you, glory to the Lord." In other words, remember who you are. "God of Israel, and make confession to him," not to Joshua, but to God. "And tell me now what you have done. Do not," here comes the command, "do not hide it from me." And Achan answered Joshua and said, indeed, he's addressing in the spirit the Lord, said to Joshua and said, "Indeed, I have sinned against the Lord God of Israel, and thus have I done. When I saw among the spoil a goodly cloak of Shinar and 200 shekels of silver and a wedge of gold of 50 shekels weight, then I coveted them. That's a sin. And they knew better. They had the Ten Commandments. I coveted them and took them, and behold, they are hidden in the earth in the middle of my tent and the silver under it. So Joshua sent the messengers, and they ran to the tent, and behold, it was hidden in the tent and the silver under it. And they took them out of the tent and brought them to Joshua and to all the children of Israel. So this is done before the body, and laid them out before the Lord. Key. And Joshua and all Israel with him took Achan, the son of Zerach, and the silver, the garment, the wedge of gold, his sons, his daughters, his oxen, his donkeys, his sheep, his tent, and all that he had, and they brought them to the valley of Achor, which means troubling. Achor means troubling. And Joshua said, "Why have you troubled us? The Lord will trouble you this day." So as he had troubled the Lord, so he would be troubled. And all Israel stoned him with stones, and they burned them with fire and stoned with stones. Here comes another pile of rocks. And they raised a great heap of stones over him that remains to this day. So that when you come across that heap of stones, you remind the children what happens when you say you will and you don't. So the Lord turned them from the fierceness of his anger. Therefore, the name of that place was called the Valley of Achor, or trouble, to this day. So then, I'll tell the rest of the story quickly. God gives Joshua a plan to conquer Ai. So he uses the defeat to fool them, to trick them. So he sends out a group of soldiers to go to the north side of Ai, behind the city. So here are the Israelites, here's the city, and he sends a whole group of warriors behind in the nighttime, quietly. Then he and the rest of the troop, in the morning, they come toward the city as if they're going to fight again. And the people in Ai are all encouraged because they drove them out the day before. So they come roaring out of the city to challenge them. They turn, the Israelites turn and run. And the people behind come in and take the empty city. But what the Israeli or the Hebrew warriors come in and take the city to is empty. So they come in and totally occupy the city. So then the Hebrew people over here turn around and challenge them, the people from Ai, back into the city where they are completely annihilated by the warriors that are already there. Now, what do you think the people, the Canaanite people, think now about the people of God? Is the terror back? Yes. God will have his way with mankind. You will either be for him or against him. And we look at the crucifixion of Jesus. They were against him. And God raised him from the dead. And what happened? They started coming by the thousands. Because he will have his way. He will have victory. He'll have victory in your heart and soul. It will be completed in you. You confess his name, you're his, he'll finish the work. Mm-hmm. It's up to you about how hard it's going to be. Can you keep your word? It's hard to keep your word. Yeah. Especially now, we have built a Tower of Babel that is so great, it's unbelievable. I mean, you cannot embrace it. It's out of control of mankind at this point. And in the meanwhile, while all this is going on, there's something greater than the internet present. And we represent it. Whoa. So what you represent, is it greater than the internet? Is it greater than sons and wonders, signs and wonders, what you represent? When you say you'll follow Jesus, you represent his kingdom on earth as it is in heaven. How well are we doing? Do we fear our neighbor who is an atheist? Or do we represent God in the midst of the atheist's life, whether he's ever converted or not? It's not up to us to change another human being. It's up to us to be all that we are in the midst of all relationships. And we cannot do that apart from the one who created us and made us who we are. So Joshua, son of Nun, was that man until the very end of his life. And he retired, I think, to Gilgal by the well. And he died at 110 years old. Weary of making war. But he brought peace. There was peace in the land. Except for one little thing. They hadn't destroyed all the Canaanites.
And what?
I'm sorry.
Canaanites. They left some of them. They didn't finish. They didn't finish the job. So we move on into the prophets, and we have all kinds of battles. With, you know, then we have the kings, and Goliath was a Philistine, a Canaanite. No, so it goes on into scripture. They are continually, the thorn in their flesh was that they hadn't finished the job. And this is the problem we have. We get a fix, we get some peace, and we move on without reckoning in relationship with what we just accomplished. We forget what God does for us and with us. We forget. Mm-hmm. So the challenge is to relive in remembrance of him every day. Okay. That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you. That was great.
All right.
Jane.
Yes.
Thank you.
God told Saul to destroy all the people. He everything, and Saul kept some of them.
That's right. He didn't do it the way he was told.
And he spared the king, did he not? Mm-hmm. And then later, those people were the ones that killed Saul. Mm-hmm. And if Saul had done what God told him to do,
that's a what if. That's a what if. I don't go to the what ifs. Some of you here, you know, others are in here. So, the one I want to leave you with tonight is be strong, be of good courage. It's important that you remember it's good courage. Don't be afraid to die obeying one of God's commands, because you have eternal life. So that's another lesson. Dying is part of the process of living. Mm-hmm. We'll do that some other time. The fullness
yeah,
of life.
That was so good, wasn't it, you guys?
Yeah.
So.
Yes.
So I had one word given to me today. I'm just going to give it real quick and just tell you that the Lord really spoke to me this morning about, if you have failed, and you think you've gone too far, or if people have failed you and they have gone too far and you want to give up hope, the Lord says, get up.
Pick up your mat.
Get up. Keep going. Don't stop, because your courage has a great reward for you.
Right.
And that's what you were saying too. Get up, get back up. If you didn't do well, just do better now. Just do better. Don't go into shame, guilt, have courage. It takes strong people these days to have courage and live in a world of faith. Father, we thank you so much for your Holy Spirit that gives us faith, gives us courage, and gives us strength. I pray that we would face our battles, Father God, head on, in the courage and in the strength and the might and the humility of the Lord, and that we would not turn back, and we would not give in to fear, and we would not cater to what people want, but we would listen to you, Lord. Open our ears to hear your voice. Open our hearts to receive what you say. Let us hear the hard word and to follow in your footsteps. We give thanks for what's been taught tonight. And I ask that you go with each person tonight and keep us safe on that road home. Mm-hmm. And be with us, be with our families in such a way, Father God, that when we walk in that door, they say, wow, they've been in the presence of the Holy Spirit. They've been in the presence of the Lord. We give thanks in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Good night, everyone. Thank you for patience tonight. I appreciate it.
And I'll see you tomorrow.
See you tomorrow.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Good night.
Good night.
Night. Bye. Bye.